In 1956, Brazilian scientist Warwick Estevam Kerr attempted to create a breed of honeybee that would produce more honey in tropical climates by crossbreeding the common European honeybee with the East African lowland honeybee. European honeybees, like the common Italian honeybee, have been cultivated by European beekeepers for centuries. The result is a breed of bee that is largely docile, even when beekeepers are disturbing their hives. They're very good producers of honey and are capable of surviving European winters by producing excess honey stores that will sustain them until the flowers begin to bloom again in the spring. African bees, however, were never domesticated, for lack of a better term, because the native population, the native Africans, never developed beekeeping. When Africans would harvest honey, they would often destroy a feral beehive rather than keep domestic hives that would be reused. So African bees were never bred for temperament or honey production. In fact, the African bee compared to the European bee is a poor producer of honey, but also very aggressive, because when Africans would harvest the honey, they would destroy the hive, and the more aggressive bees would survive. They also had another natural predator, the well-known honey badger. African bees protect their hives with more guard bees than European bees, and they have a much wider attack radius around their hive. They also attack with swarms several times as large as European bees and continue to attack for longer distances. Kerr hoped by breeding the European bees, which were ill-suited for the tropical climate of Brazil, with the African bees, he could increase honey production and have a bee that would withstand the local conditions. The result was the Africanized honeybee, or what is commonly known today as the killer bee. In many ways, Kerr achieved what he set out to do. This genetically engineered bee did survive better in tropical climates, and it also produced more honey than the European bee. It was almost as if he got the best of both worlds. But, unfortunately, as everyone knows and is willing to openly admit about every animal from bees to different dog breeds, anything on earth, as long as you aren't talking about humans, temperament is also genetic. These new bees didn't just attack intruders with 3 to 4 times the amount of bees that their European relatives did, but 10 times. They also had even more guard bees than their African relatives, and with an even wider attack radius. This new, unnatural breed of bee chases its victims for up to a mile and will often sting a threat until and after it's dead. These bees have been known to sting animals and people to death and then continue to sting the corpse. To make matters worse, killer bees are even hostile to other bees. The way bees spread out and create new hives is they gather together in a swarm. Scout bees find a new location for a hive, and the swarm then moves into the new location. Killer bees swarm and create new hives over twice as often as European bees, and often invade existing European bee colonies and take them over. And in 1957, 26 swarms of killer bees escaped captivity. The official story, which seems a little weak to me, is that some unnamed visiting scientist unwittingly removed the screens on the beehives that prevented the larger drones and queens, the non-worker bees that are required for these swarms to move off and create a new hive. The screens that were too small for them to fit through were removed because this so-called unnamed visiting scientist took them off because he thought they were unnecessary. With the screens gone, and apparently all of the Brazilian scientists completely asleep at the wheel, the killer bees formed 26 swarms and left to create new colonies out in the wild, and the cat was out of the bag. The story's pretty flimsy and basically makes Jurassic Park seem kind of realistic. Kerr just wanted to know if he could produce this new honeybee, but never stopped to ask if he should or take the proper precautions about releasing it out in the wild. And now, 60 years later, killer bees have saturated almost all of South America, all of Central America and Mexico, and have spread throughout the southern half of the United States. And by spread, I don't mean killer bees living hand in hand next door to the happy European bees. You see, once again, we see another example in the animal kingdom where scientists all nod their heads in agreement. Of course, multiculturalism doesn't work with bees. Didn't you know? That's also something that's only humans are the exception. Humans can do it successfully, but certainly nothing else, especially not killer bees. You see, killer bees don't just outbreed the European bees and spread out and make more hives more often, but they take over the European hives by sneaking past the more docile, trusting European guard bees. They sneak past and kill the queen, and then they install their own queen. The European worker bees, they just continue to work day and night, and they support the Africanized queen and her children until they eventually die off, and the hive built by the European bees is occupied entirely by the invaders and their brood. This is so common that many areas have no trace at all of the European bee population. The European bees have been completely obliterated. In fact, the killer bees have been successfully conquering territory at a rate of about 1 mile per day. One of the only things that's even kind of slowing down the spread of the Africanized bees, their brutal march northward, is one of the traits they inherited from their African descendants. They don't make adequate preparations that would allow them to survive longer winters. They don't store enough honey when the weather is good and the flowers are blooming. And as a result, they run out of honey in the winter and they die. That said, killer bee colonies have still been discovered as far north as Maryland. So why am I talking about killer bees? Well, I assure you, 100%, there's absolutely nothing at all to learn metaphorically from this at all. Nothing at all. I just found myself in a position where I had to do some research on bees. This is true. If you subscribe or follow me on social media, you might know I'm in the process of moving out to my homestead, or as I sometimes call it, my bunker. We had a storm recently, and the storm knocked down a couple of my trees, and I went to go saw the trees up with a chainsaw because they were smashing part of my fence. And before I could chop up the trees, I heard a buzzing sound, very loud, unnerving buzzing sound. And I looked up and saw a stream of bees going in and out of my roof. Unfortunately, these bees turned out to be killer bees. If they had been European bees, I probably would have attempted to relocate them. But unfortunately, they were Africanized, which meant there was really only one thing I could do. The bees, their door is sealed off, and I made this bee vacuum that's sucking up the ones coming home. And it's just filled with bees. That clicking sound you hear is our bees rolling down the tube. So this is where their hole was. You can see them getting sucked down as they fly up to it. So now the trick is to drill a hole in the ceiling on the inside of the house, right where that's at. Yes, this is 100% real. It's also why I haven't had videos posted as frequently lately. I'm almost all the way moved in to the homestead or bunker or whatever I want to call it. I'll probably come up with a cooler name. But I've been dealing with literal killer bees in my roof, which is leaking, and I haven't been able to fix the roof because it was full of bees. And now that the bees are gone, I hope there might still be bees in my wall. This is an ongoing thing. But I have to take care of the roof that's leaking and a couple other things just to make it livable. And then I'm going to be out of my apartment and out there. And I'm still also trying to figure out internet out there because it's not exactly in a broadband area. But I'll get that figured out. I'm also working on three videos. One on a TV series that aired for over 10 years straight that I think you guys will find interesting. One on a movie that I had to get on VHS because it's not available online anywhere, legally or illegally. And a third one, a film that was so long it had an intermission when it was in theaters. So I'll let you guys ponder that. In the meantime, thanks to all the people who are patrons on Patreon, and thanks to everyone who's picked up a copy of my book. The audiobook should be out very, 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 very soon. It's just I'm waiting for the final approval from the company, which I was supposed to get like a week ago. I don't know. I haven't heard anything from them. It's 100% out of my hands. They have everything. All they have to do is click the green button and it'll be live, and then nothing should have to be done. It's just going through what they called a quality control process, which hopefully doesn't mean, you know, ideological purity process or something like that, but I'll let you guys know as soon as that is available. I'm just waiting for a response, so I'll keep you guys posted on that. For Blackpilled, I'm Devin Stack. If you like my videos, make sure you like and subscribe. Make sure you share. If you want to support my videos, you can grab a copy of my book, Day of the Rope. Link is in the description. Or you can become a patron at patreon.com/blackpilled or send crypto to one of the addresses below.